It's Sister Catherine at the hospice.
And Sister Lucy?
I know you can't speak, but will you open your eye, Queenie, if you can hear us?
She did it. She opened her eye.
Good morning, Queenie.
Yes, I'm in here. Here I am.
It's a beautiful day.
Dear Harold, your letter arrived this morning. We were in the day room for morning activities. Everyone was asleep.
Scrabble, anyone?
Life is different for me at the hospice. I sit apart. Every day a dying. Every day the undertaker's van. But I close my eyes and I pretend that the heat of the radiator is the sun on my hands. The patients cough, and that is only the wind in my garden by the sea. I see the flowers and the shell paths and the wind's chimes. I see the driftwood figures. I am not here at all.
Post, everyone! Mr. Henderson.
Oh, another brown envelope. Thank you, Sister Catherine.
A letter for you, Finty. Oh. It looks like junk mail.
Whoa. Are we here?
And today, Queenie, something for you.
Yeah, I've won a prize. I've just got to scratch off this silver window.
Do you want me to read your letter for you, Queenie?
Thank you, Sister Lucy.
It's from someone called Harold Fry.
Oh, isn't he the man we wrote to a few days ago?
To say a goodbye. He says, I am very sorry. Well, that's nice. And there's a PS. Wait for me.
Well, maybe he's going to visit.
Did you hear that, Queenie? A visitor?
Oh, don't cry. Maybe Harold Fry will come tomorrow.
Well, did you say Harold Fry? He rang yesterday from a phone box. Well, the line was bad and he kept laughing. Couldn't understand a word. Now I think of it, he was saying the same thing. He said to tell you he was walking. Oh. I took a note. Here it is. As long as he walks, you must wait. He said he was leaving Kingsbridge. Does anyone know where that is?
Devon. It's South Devon.
Oh, I mean, he's walking to Berwick from all the way down there, but that's a very long way. Maybe Harold Fry won't visit after all.
I closed my eyes. A little later, I felt the sisters hook their arms beneath me and lift my body into the wheelchair.
Gently.
Can't she hear?
She's sleeping.
I feel awful about that letter. Him saying he's walking.
What do you want to know?
She only has a few days.
I kept my eyes shut, afraid that if I opened them, the wash of tears would never stop. Harold Fry is coming. I've waited 20 years, and now you are coming.
Queenie.
When I woke, a new volunteer was standing by me. For a moment, she looked made of light. I tried to hide so she wouldn't see the thing growing on my face. But she only smiled.
I've heard the exciting news about Harold Fry. You don't know me. This is my first day at the hospice. Sister Mary Anconew, pleased to meet you.
I reached for my notebook. I wrote her a message. How can I wait for Harold Fry? It's too late.
Too late? It's never too late. You wrote him a letter to say goodbye, and now he has written back to say wait for him.
I am dying. I am here to die.
Oh, pardon me, but you're here to live until you die. There's a significant difference. So I have a plan. We're going to write a second letter. Tell Harold Fry everything he doesn't know. I will help. There's an old portable typewriter in the office. You can make notes and I'll type them. We will write to you and I until Harold Fry gets here, and that is how you will keep waiting.
We worked all day.
Harold Fry is walking. But in another way, even though you're here, even though you've done your travelling, you're starting a journey too. It's the same and not the same. You see?
When I woke this morning, I had a visitor. She had a grapefruit on her head. She also bought her horse. The two of them only left when Sister Mary Ankenu arrived with her typewriter. I wrote for her that I'd had strange guests who belonged to a circus, not a hospice.
People pay good money for drugs like yours. I see you have another postcard. Keep faith, Harold Fry. It's a picture of Bantham Beach. Shall we get back to your letter?
Cramp. Must have been all the writing I did yesterday. My fingers trembled like anemones in the rock pools of my garden. I made it by the sea, and so I called it a sea garden.
Give me your hands. Rub-a-dub-dub.
Later, Sister Lucy fetched her sparkly polish and painted my nails.
Look at you, with your nails all sparkly. Shall we try again?
Yes, I remember Bantham Beach. I went there, Harold, when I first arrived in Devon. This was 24 years ago, before you and I met. Hadn't intended to come to Devon, but things had gone wrong for me. So I was doing what I always did when something went wrong, was running away. I walked to the sea's edge. Why didn't I keep going? I had little money, no job. The water tipped my shoes. And then I felt the growing bump of my belly. I am starting again, I thought, because that is what you do when you reach the end. You make a new beginning. The next thing I needed was a job. The irony is, Harold, I wasn't even a trained accountant. I'd got a first in classics from Oxford. The nearest I'd come to an accounts book was when I worked as a politician's assistant. I'd never met a man like Napier.
You?
I saw the advert in the local paper.
But this is a brewery.
I can still be an accountant.
Landlords are fiddling the books. I need a man to find out who they are.
Mr. Napier, you may not have noticed, but we have a woman as Prime Minister. I've had several jobs and excelled in all of them.
You're not the person I'm looking for.
You at least have to interview me. Equal rights and so on.
I waited all day, Harold. It was in me to get up and leave. But I needed the job. I needed the money.
Go away.
I'm still here, Mr. Napier.
What? You don't touch.
He pointed to a collection of Murano glass clowns glowing on his desk. Like a band of melting musicians.
Nobody at the brewery touches the clowns. They were my mother's. Understood?
Does that mean I've got the job?
Look, Queenie, three new postcards.
Shall I read them out?
Dear Queenie, I have blisters on my blisters, but continue to walk. Dear Queenie, I have come approximately 20 miles. Do not give up. Dear Queenie... Nice day.
Who is this man?
He's called Harold Fry, Mr. Henderson.
He wrote the other day.
And he says what? Wait for him.
He does seem to be saying that.
And he walks the length of England.
Mm-hmm.
What an idiot.
Would you like to do today's crossword, Mr. Henderson?
Oh, what's the point? I may not be here tomorrow.
I wish some old bloke could walk for me. Even a stroll to the office and back would be nice.
Harold must be an old friend of Queenie's. She must have met him a long time ago.
It's 24 years ago. This is my first day at the brewery and I'm out of my depth. But something catches my eye at my office window. snow. A metal door opens and a tall man rushes into the yard. It's you, Harold. You dispose of several empty beer cans in the bins and then you check no one is watching and you begin to dance. I've been a dancer for many years, not as a professional, just as a hobby. But I've never seen a man so light on his feet. Up at my office window, I begin to dance too. You swing to the left, I swing to the right. I look out for you every day after that. I'm having a hard time. I want to meet the tall man who danced in the snow.
Oh, I do
better, huh? Oh, I'm fine.
You don't what? Need anything?
No. I like being in the stationery cupboard.
Harold Fry, please to
I've had enough. This is a terrible place. The men are awful. I'm good to resign. Ignore me. I'm having a lovely day.
Don't resign, Mrs.
Miss Hennessy.
I found it hard at the beginning. I felt out of place, but it will get better. I promise. Would you like to come out of the stationery cupboard now? Here, take my hand.
Oh,
what I didn't tell you, Harold, was that I'd been pregnant when I first came to Kingsbridge. What I didn't say was that I had lost my baby only the previous weekend. It was the first time anyone had been kind to me.
You'll be okay, Miss Hennessy.
Yes, I will now.
No post for me today.
Nothing for me, neither.
I confess I was downhearted.
What about a visit to the garden? No?
When Sister Lucy fetched the trolley of nutritional drinks, I shook my head at those two.
Listen, Ian, listen. You have a man walking the length of England. The least you can do is not kick the bucket. Now, I know you think you look like a monster with that thing going on the side of your face and... I know you can't talk, but this here is hardly a beauty pageant. I mean, I'm carrying the contents of me bowels in me handbag. Either you take the milkshakes or you won't make it to the end of the week. Now, which is it gonna be?
I pointed to the drinks.
Right, gather up, everyone. We're getting around.
Things changed. You look happy. Did you have a nice time today?
It is 6 days since you began your walk. I can wait for you, Harold Fry. Today, Harold, I tried to ask Sister Lucy if I could borrow a dictionary and a thesaurus in order to help with my letter. She is the youngest of the volunteers, and her face is cherry blossom pink. She wants to understand me.
Oh, I didn't get it. No, it's my fault. Don't write it in your notebook. Try me again.
I had another go.
Oh, I understand. Wait there.
As if I am going anywhere.
Ta-da!
She brought Pictionary and a throat lozenge.
Also a glass of water. Would you like me to paint your nails?
Post, everyone.
Another postcard from you. This one has a picture of the Bluebell steam train. No message. You seem to have forgotten that bit.
The man's still walking.
This is his ninth day, Finty.
If he got on a train, he could be at the hospice this afternoon.
Oh, that's not the point, you old bastard. Any fool can sit on a train.
Have you any idea how far it is from Kingsbridge to Berwick-upon-Tweed? Have you any idea how many miles?
Oh, of course I do, Mr. Henderson. It's a heck of a lot.
There are over 600 of them.
I couldn't do it.
Has Harold Fry no idea what a hospice is? He's making fools. Fools.
Mr. Henderson.
Just let me die, will you?
I guess it is a long way.
Once I was in my room, I wrote in my notebook. I showed the message to Sister Mary Ankornu, who was helping me type this letter.
Mr. Henderson is right. It's too far to walk. I can't wait. You need to look at things from a different perspective.
I don't know if you have noticed, but how fries. Still seems to be in southwest England.
I do admit that is a problem. But I sense you let him down. So you must confess the truth. Tell Harold Fry what happened after he was kind to you in the stationery cupboard. I know this is difficult, but we can take it slowly. One word in front of the other.
I never lost the extra flesh I had gained when I was pregnant. Maybe I kept it because it was all I had left of my baby. Napier and the other reps made fun of my shape, my walk. So I put up my chin and I waddled more. I realised I was falling in love with you. And so it was time to move on. I went back to Napier.
You want to do what?
He hit the desk so hard, his glass clowns trembled like frightened girls.
You've only been here 3 months.
An accountant has to go into the pubs. That's the only way to catch landlords fiddling the books. You need someone with a driving licence.
You want a driver?
Well, I realise a driver's out of the question, which is why I have to resign.
Harold Fry will be your driver.
I get car sick.
You get car sick?
Yeah, yes, I do.
Okay, I'll fire him.
I beg your pardon?
He's old-fashioned, dull as ditch water.
Fire Harold Fry? He's one of your oldest employees. He has a family.
Have you seen the way his son struts around Kingsbridge? Like he owns the place?
I don't know about his son, but Harold Fry is a good man.
Do you think I care?
Of course you don't. Let me get this straight. If I stay, Harold Fry keeps his job?
I'm not saying I like you, but you're a good accountant. You stay, Harold Fry stays too.
We took our first trip, you and I, a few days later. And I'm sorry to break this to you, Harold. I was dreading it.
Oh, you did well today.
I did?
Yeah, he's a slippery chap, that man. Would you put him through his paces? You had him quaking.
Me?
You're a good accountant. Well, here we go. Last stop, the brewery.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
I mean, thank you for a few weeks ago when we were in the stationery cupboard. I was upset.
Yes.
You were kind. You are a gentleman. Mint?
Pardon?
Would you care for one?
Thank you.
Well, see you next week, Mr. Fry.
Yes, Miss Hennessy.
Rain all night. My head whirs, words, words. Even when I sleep, they wake me. I will never get to the end of my letter.
You have a temperature. You need to stop writing, Queenie.
Sister Catherine changes the dressing on my face and neck. And Sister Lucy gives me my medication.
All right.
The moment they've gone, I am writing again. During the course of our drives, Harold, I came to know you better.
All set, Miss Hennessy?
All set, Mr. Fry.
Sorry.
You have a lively taste in music.
Well, no, it's not my tape, it's my son's. He prefers listening to music than talking to his father. Well, he's hoping to go to Cambridge to do classics.
I read classics at Oxford.
Gosh, golly.
Is that all you can say?
Well, what do you want me to say?
I don't know. They're such funny words. I thought no one said things like that.
Maybe I say them when I'm nervous.
Do I make you nervous?
A bit.
I still have some of my textbooks from university. Your son could borrow them if he likes.
By the way, that dress looks nice on you.
Oh, it's a suit. A plain brown suit. I bought it from a charity shop.
Well, I don't know. It still looks nice.
Gosh. Golly.
When I was a teenager, my mother told me that people fall in love because the timing is right. I had no baby, and so I gave my love to you. I loved everything about you. Your laugh, your yachting shoes, your fawn pullover and fawn trousers. When I ran away and made my home in Northumberland, I lit blue lamps in my garden, and as dusk came, it was like watching your blue eyes. I found a piece of driftwood on the beach, and because it was tall and straight, I set it in my garden. And it reminded me of you.
Hard-boiled eggs, ham.
Also celery salt, tomatoes, tinned peaches and a Mars bar.
Thank you, Miss Hennessy.
Please call me Queenie.
Well, then, you must call me Harold.
I never liked my name. It was my father who chose it. I always wanted my friends to call me something else.
Well, like what?
Like Sharon.
I don't have many.
Many what?
Friends. I have Maureen.
Your wife?
Yes, I have my son, David, but... Well, there isn't anyone else. My mother walked out on the eve of my 13th birthday. My father drank. This is why I don't.
You don't drink?
Briefly, I thought of the beer cans I had seen you get rid of every day.
Well, when it came to friends, I never knew what to say.
You have me, Harold. I'm your friend.
That dress looks nice on you.
Is this your way of saying thank you?
Pass the celery salt, will you?
Another death in the night. The undertaker's car was here this morning. After 13 days of riding, my hand felt skewered. I was too unwell to leave my bed.
There's a swelling on the parotid gland.
I see.
And what's happened to her hand?
It looks infected.
Here. Morphine to relieve the pain. Can you drink? I'll ask the duty nurse to dress your hand.
I asked for Sister Mary Ann Canoe, but they didn't understand. There was no sign of her for 2 more days.
Look what I have for you on this lovely afternoon. Oh dear. A bandage. Poor old hand. Well, you've been overdoing it, dear heart. You can't keep busy every minute, otherwise you're not waiting. It's time to concentrate your energy on other things. Like this peach, for instance. Look at it. What a beauty. Let's cut it open. Oh, smell that. Put a piece in your mouth.
I can't. I can't.
You don't have to swallow it if you don't want to.
Oh, my body trembles with pleasure. If I die choking on a peach, at least it won't taste of milkshakes. There. The peach is gone.
You see? You ate a peach. You thought you couldn't, but you could.
Another postcard, Harold, arrived today in the day room. This one is from Taunton. Apparently you had a day of rest with the woman who cleaned your feet and repaired your shoes.
Oh, I love that Slovak girl. I want to snug her at you. I love Harold Fry and all. I'm going to marry him when he gets here.
You won't be alive when he gets here. None of us will.
I'm glad he had a rest in Taunton. It must have been exhausting, all that walking.
It's racing along. He'll be here any day.
A woman washed his feet. Who does Harold Fry think he is? Jesus Christ!
I began to write you poems. Love poems. How else could I express my feelings? I kept them in the zip-up pocket of my handbag, where you'd never find them.
Penny, for your thoughts?
Before I came to Kingsbridge, my life was a mess.
Oh?
I was living with the wrong man. I got pregnant. I ran away. I was always running away. Ever since I was a teenager and outgrew my parents. But this time, Harold, I'm going to stay in one place. I'm going to make my home here and grow old. I will always be here for you.
Thank you, Queenie.
Of course, I didn't say that. I only thought it. This is how the conversation really went.
Penny, for your thoughts?
Mint?
Oh, I don't mind if I do. Thank you, Queenie.
There can be no more writing today. My hand is sore, and I've learnt my lesson. You don't get to a place by constantly moving, even if your journey is only one of waiting. Tonight, the garden is still. A pearl-white moon shines through the curtains. I wait. I remember. Tomorrow, I will tell you.
Another beautiful day. She wants something. Do you want something?
I must keep writing.
A notebook. She's pointing to a notebook.
24 years ago, Harold, everything had made a place for itself.
So you have to do that?
What?
Give those funny hand signals every time you turn left or right. I thought that's what the indicators were for.
Are you saying I'm an old-fashioned driver?
I'm just saying you're a very careful one.
I'm supposed to take care of you. That's my job. Besides, it makes the car go faster. You should wind down your window and help.
Whee!
I wrote you love poems that I kept hidden in my handbag. Every Thursday I took a night bus and went ballroom dancing in Taunton. And sometimes, yes, I danced in the arms of a stranger and pretended he was you. I loved you and you didn't know. But that was enough for me. And then I met your son.
Ah! What did you have to do that for?
It's summer.
I'm soaked!
I've been caught in a sudden storm on the high street. When I notice a young man shouting at some poor driver.
And why the hell do you need a sports car? This is Kingsbridge, not Monaco.
People begin to stop. They shout at him to calm down. So he rounds on them too.
Reader of Tory newspapers?
He is tall, thin.
Drinker of Rotary Club wine?
I'd know that figure anywhere. Our boss Napier emerges from a pub with one of his henchmen. There is going to be a fight. And no one is going to look after your son.
Excuse me. David, Come along.
What the?
Yes, walk this way. It's all right. Everyone, nothing to see.
What was that about?
I know your father. I work with him at the brewery.
Right.
You were about to get in a lot of trouble.
Kingsbridge needs some trouble. Smoke?
No, thank you.
Do you have any cash?
Are you serious?
I am, actually. Sorry about that.
I'll give you £1.
The note should do it.
I'm not giving you £5.
Well, my wallet got stolen. Are you going to give me this money?
What about a cup of tea?
You can buy me a can of beer.
Of course, Harold. The beer cans you dispose of every day, they don't belong to you. They belong to your son. That's why you hide them. I feel a flush of tenderness for you that makes my throat thicken.
See you around, Queenie Hennessy.
This morning, Harold, something unexpected occurred in the day room.
Why are there two calendar pages stuck to the notice board?
I put them there. One is for April. It has a picture of spring bulbs in Berwick upon Tweed. The other is for me. It has a picture of a kitten.
Oh, I had a kitten once. Oh, it loved me, that cat. It's about the only thing that did.
Was the kitten also from Berwick upon Tweed?
It doesn't say. I have coloured in every day that Harold Fry has been walking. Today is his 20th day.
What's the other picture?
Oh, just a man walking. I snipped it from a magazine.
But that's John Travolta. Blimey, is he coming as well?
No, I don't. It's only Queenie's friend who's walking.
I don't understand. Why is there a picture of a kitten in Berwick upon Tweed? Miss Hennessy?
But I was back with my notebook. You were on your annual holiday with your wife, and it shocked me how much I missed you. Napier had provided me with a younger rep as my driver. He drove fast and yawned a lot, often both at the same time. I needed to dance with a tall man and pretend for a few moments. I was with you again.
Look at you, Queenie Hennessy. Where are you off to tonight?
Never you mind.
Never you mind? Well, that sounds fun.
I hadn't mentioned to you that I had met David because I didn't want you to know he'd almost got in a fight and then asked me for money. I thought it would embarrass you. Besides, I'd assumed I'd never see him again.
This is my bus, David. I must go. Totnes, please. The Royal Dance Hall.
I'll come with you. What's the average age here? 60?
About that.
And they just dance?
Ballroom dancing.
Couldn't you go dancing in Kingsbridge?
If I went dancing in Kingsbridge, people might know me.
And you don't want people to know you?
I like to go by myself.
I've got the music in me! I've got the music in me!
Shh, will you?
Oh, don't worry. I won't embarrass you in front of your friends.
I told you, I don't have friends here. I only come to dance.
Whatever you do, I'll sit quietly.
He didn't, of course. He couldn't resist getting up. He began with the rumba, then a waltz, and he ended up pogo jumping.
This is brilliant!
Yes, David. So is the foxtrot.
I taught your son to dance.
Well, that was fun.
It was my father who taught me. I used to stand on his shoes while my mother sang the tune. He loved the game, my father. Sometimes when he came home, he'd pretend he couldn't see me and I'd be shouting, "Here I am, here I am." I thought it was so funny.
Here I am, here I am.
Exactly. Your father will laugh when he hears about tonight.
Don't tell father.
But he's a dancer too.
You're joking. He just sits. Don't tell him. Got it? Please. Please, Queenie. Don't tell him.
I had no idea what to do.
But did you tell Harold, Queenie, that you had met his son, that you went dancing?
I meant to tell you, Harold.
You promised to confess the truth.
But you can miss saying the right thing by a second, and suddenly it is too late to go back.
Did you miss me while I was away?
I have a life.
So what did you get up to?
Harold, there's something I need to tell you.
Are you all right?
When you've gone... Oh, this is so difficult.
You look pale. I'll pull over. It wasn't such a good holiday. My wife worried. She worries about our son, about David.
Why?
I keep telling her he's fine. He will be fine. He's going to Cambridge at the end of the summer. No need to worry. Sorry, what were you going to say?
Nothing.
I'll drive on then, shall I?
Yes, Harold, let's drive on.
I avoided the dance hall for a few weeks, but at the end of summer, I went again. I thought it would be safe. But David was waiting for me at the bus stop. Once again, he came with me. We danced. He talked all the way home.
Father said you'd lend me some of your textbooks.
Oh, I'm glad he knows that we're friends. That's good, David.
He hasn't a clue. He said he knew someone at work. Thinks I'm stupid. Sometimes, Q, it's like I don't belong.
Where?
Anywhere.
I don't know why you talk about your father like that.
Like what?
As if he's beneath you. He likes to make people smile. Mint?
Give over with a sweet excuse. Say something real.
I'm in love with a man who doesn't love me.
Who?
Doesn't matter.
Does he know?
Oh, no.
Do you think I'll be okay at university?
Hello. Do you hear me out there, Harold? There's been more death here. The undertaker's gone. I have been waiting for 31 days. But tonight is too much.
There's more swelling.
And an infection in the right eye. Can you drink, Queenie? I'm going to change your dressing.
Morphine will take the pain away.
The horse is back. So is the lady with the grapefruit. I don't want to think about the past anymore. It hurts. And it hurts to wait.
You've got yourself in another pickle. It's all very well for a man to tell his friend to wait while he walks the length of England. It is an entirely different kettle of fish when you're the woman at the other end. You have to take care. Look at the window, Queenie. What do you see?
Clouds. Grey ones. This is England. What do you expect?
The sky is always there. It's the clouds that come and go. Don't plan ahead. Watch the sky with me.
For a few days, I have not written. I have lain very still and watched the sky. And then I have slept.
Good news! Good news!
What's happened?
I've got a pot of clogs. I'm so excited.
Harold Fry has just telephoned.
Oh, can you hear that, Queenie?
He is in Stroud. He is still walking. He said to keep waiting. He will be here in 3 weeks.
Oh, well. The man appears to be true to his word.
Yay. Didn't I tell you, girl? Didn't I tell you not to give up?
Sister Lucy, might I borrow your pen? I think I will do today's crossword after all.
I assembled my old textbooks in a pile in case David came for them.
Here I am. Can I come in?
It's very small here.
Nice place.
The books. When do you leave for Cambridge?
Tomorrow. Parents are driving me.
Well, I'm sure you've got lots to do.
I'll sit here, shall I?
David, your father does know that you're here.
Don't worry. Our secret's safe.
But I don't want a secret.
I had to go and wash my face. It was too much. When I came back, David was already taking my books.
Wish me luck, Hugh.
That night, I couldn't stop crying. It hurt so much to keep deceiving you. It was only as I switched off the lights that my heart froze. My handbag was open. David had emptied my purse. But that was not the worst. My love poems were gone. I had no news from David at university. I asked you sometimes, Harold. Any news?
No, he's much too busy.
Not even a letter?
He's probably doing all those student-y things that, students do.
I was certain he'd stolen my love poems, but there was no reason to believe he'd told you. A year passed. David didn't show up. You took your summer holiday, and when I asked what you had done, you laughed.
No, I mowed the lawn. I mowed it quite a lot.
Another Christmas came, and there you were, secretly disposing of empty beer cans in the yard. Your son was home. It was the annual Christmas fair in Kingsbridge. A large crowd had assembled around a stage and they were laughing. From my place at the back, it was hard to see until I realised it was David. He was reciting poetry, humorous poetry.
This next one is a love poem. It's called The Love Song of a Woman Who's Never Had It.
David went on to recite, word for word, one of my poems. There followed four or five more, and each time the crowd laughed and jeered. I ran as fast as I could. I had never felt so ashamed. My love was a joke.
Today you have a new postcard. Listen to all the places Harold Fry has passed since he telephoned us from Stroud.
Oh, gather up, everyone.
Cheltenham.
Oh, I haven't been to Cheltenham since I got arrested.
Stratford.
Oh, I haven't been to Stratford since I saw King Lear.
And now he's in Baggington. A few days ago, he met a nice young man who took his photograph and bought him a lemonade. And from now on, he will travel without money and rely on the kindness of strangers.
I'm not even going to comment.
New Year came. I had known you for 2 years, Harold, and still you didn't realise what I felt. I couldn't stop thinking of my stupid poems. If only I'd never written them.
Queenie! Let me in!
Peace offering?
I don't drink whiskey.
Saw you. At the Christmas fair. You ran off.
I don't want to talk.
The parents are driving me mad. Oh, come on, Q. It's freezing out here. Let me in.
I gave him 5 minutes.
University was okay to begin with, but I got out of my depth. I can't do the work. Got no friends. Poetry's a kind of way of showing who I am.
But that was my poetry. You stole it from my handbag. How can people see who you are if you're reciting my poetry?
You're seeing me, Q, and you're seeing I'm fake.
You have to show your heart, David, when you write.
Is that what you were doing in your poems? Who were they for?
No one you know.
Thought as much. I'm going to keep writing. Show my heart. I'm going to stop the drink. I'll send them, shall I? I'll send you my new poems from Cambridge. I'm really sorry, Q. I didn't mean to hurt you. But I know now, you're the only person who understands.
I'm going to be honest with you, Harold. David's poems weren't up to much. By the end of his second year, they had begun to turn dark. I was worried, and I had no idea how to say it. If I told you about his poems, I'd have to tell you about mine.
One for the road.
Cheers.
Cheers.
I'd have to confess I loved you.
One day I'll come here with my son. We'll talk man to man.
Have you heard from him lately?
He's much too busy. It's hard for my wife. She misses him very much. It'll be easier to talk, the two of us, when he's older.
I can't imagine your son in yachting shoes.
Why? Have you met him?
You gave it to me on a plate. It would have been so easy to come clean.
Queenie?
Then I thought of that crowd, laughing.
Of course I haven't.
You'd like him, you know. He'd like you.
It was all becoming too much. Last night, I dreamt I went to my sea garden again. I touched the driftwood figures. The tall one at the centre that I put there many, many years ago because it reminded me of you. And then the smaller ones that I found over the years. The thorny, fragile piece for David and two interwoven branches for my parents. In my sea garden, I looked after all the people I have left behind. When I woke, I was crying. I could barely write.
What's this in your notebook? What will happen to my garden? Is that a question for Harold? Or is this one for me? Queenie, have you made a will yet? It's not so terrible, dear heart, to make a will. I know it is frightening to think of letting go, but that's only because you haven't done it. You need to put things straight, and I'm here to help you.
This evening, I made my will. I left my garden to the village so that they can see it when I am gone. Sister Anne Canoe was right. It was not so terrible.
Now, let's get back to your letter.
I didn't hear from David for another 6 months. It was a relief. The next time I saw him was towards the end of his third year.
Watcher.
And I was shocked.
What are you doing down on the quay?
Revising for my finals. I'm gonna fail.
You look frozen. Here, take my gloves.
They're so tiny.
How's university?
Yeah.
I miss your poems.
What's the point in writing? Better to expect nothing.
What did you expect?
To be a poet. To be famous.
Why can't you write for the sake of writing?
I'd rather be nothing. Get on with it.
David, have you thought about seeing someone at a doctor?
There's nothing wrong.
Sometimes, David, you have to think in an ordinary way. Life isn't always what we expect.
I'd rather die than be ordinary. Have you got any cash?
For 2 days I have not written. I have not felt well enough.
Scrabble? Anyone?
Oh. I've been thinking. Harold Fry's been walking for how long?
40 days.
So, listen, I may be dying, but I'm not dead yet. I'm gonna wait too.
You, Finty?
All I gotta do is sit here, and that's easier. I'm not dying till the man gets here. Is anyone gonna join me?
I looked around the day room. Sunken faces, skeletal figures,
bandages and tubes.
Oh, come on, you lot. Where's your sense of adventure? Henderson?
Are you dressing me?
Are you going to wait for Harold Fry?
If he's a friend of Queenie Hennessy's, he's a friend of mine.
Oh, yay. Henderson's in. Anyone else?
One by one, and in silence, the patients raised their hands. At last, everyone in the day room had a hand in the air.
From now on, no one dies. We're all waiting.
I could have cried, but I didn't want to go and make a fool of myself. So I said in my head, think of something else. Think of Harold Fry.
Well, Maureen says I need a new jacket.
What sort of jacket?
The sort of jacket a father wears to his son's graduation.
The jacket we bought was Harris Tweed. I never saw you wear it again. Another day, I asked how it had been, but you looked away.
It was quite itchy.
I mean the graduation ceremony. Did you enjoy it?
Yes. Well, David was very busy. We didn't really see him.
Not at all.
He's going on a walking holiday.
I didn't know he liked walking.
Oh, he's exhausted. At least he's done something with his life.
Whatever David did that holiday, he returned much worse.
I need to talk.
In the middle of the night?
No one sees me. No one knows.
I tried to warn you one last time.
Harold?
I'm just off to get rid of these.
But you don't drink.
It's for a friend. I'll see you later.
I need to talk. We need to talk. Well,
could it wait? I
won't wait. It's very important.
It's a difficult moment right now. It's difficult at home. Another time, Queenie. Another time.
But there was no other time. 2 weeks later, David was dead. The world changed. I felt a great big hole had been torn out of the centre and that without anyone knowing, I was directly responsible. When I confessed the truth, you would hate me. And yet the person I most wanted to find was you.
Queenie.
Harold.
I'm fetching a prescription for Maureen. She isn't sleeping. My son is dead. My son is dead.
I heard. I'm so sorry.
Worse for Maureen. It's always worse for the mother. But she doesn't sleep. Did I say that?
Is there anything I can do?
Do?
To help?
Oh, no, I think not. Not now.
So you buried your son? And the only time I saw you not in Fawn was the day you turned up at the brewery in a black suit.
Oh, hello.
Should you be here?
Yes.
You broke my heart. But I still couldn't tell you the truth.
Harold Fry's on the telly! Is it really him? Oh, look at that!
But who are all those other people?
And why are they playing musical instruments?
Because they're walking with him. They're walking to save us. We're going to be all right now.
Have you seen what he has on his feet? Yachting shoes!
He was the subject of thought for the day this morning. And look, Queenie, hashtag Harold Fry, hashtag Queenie Hennessy, hashtag live forever. You two are all over the place.
I am tired, Harold. I think of what I did all those years ago. And I have to close my eyes.
Queenie? What happened after David died? Why did you leave Kingsbridge?
And why, if you loved Harold Fry, have you hidden from him for 20 years? You can't give up now.
In the weeks that followed your son's death, Harold, I couldn't bear to be in my flat. I found reasons to stay on at work, and this is how I happened to be there the night of the break-in. I followed the noise. I knew it was you before I saw you, and the moment you broke inside Napier's office, I also knew what you were about to do. It was too late to stop you. Only when every one of Napier's glass clowns was smashed did your anger abate.
What are you doing here, Harold? You've been drinking! And your hands, they're covered in cuss. Go home.
I can't.
Let me deal with this one.
We didn't even say goodbye, Harold. The next morning, Napier was angrier than I had ever seen him.
I told you the rule. They were the only thing I had of my mother's. I told you.
I was bringing some papers out and I slipped. It was an accident.
You smashed every clown.
Yes, I am to blame.
I never want to see you again. Your voice, I don't even want to hear it. I don't even want to smell you. Leave. Now. Never come back.
And Harold Fry's job?
Get out!
At tea time today, Sister Lucy wheeled me to a table beside the window.
May I join you, Miss Hennessy?
I managed one grapefruit segment. Mr. Henderson had two. Then we tried the soup.
Years ago, I would have chosen a steak. I imagine you'd have asked for fish of the day. I was married once. My wife left. She employed a lawyer who was my best friend. They took me to the cleaners. I'm afraid this has made me a difficult man. I assume Harold Fry meant a great deal to you.
Sir?
I'll take the green jelly, Sister Catherine. Miss Hennessy. Miss Hennessy will take the custard.
Squeezy cream?
Squeezy cream, Miss Hennessy. No, thank you. Her cup overfloweth.
Never mind. I'll fetch a cloth.
Dark girl. Years ago, I would have suggested a stroll by the estuary, but we must be content with this.
This morning, Mr. Henderson was not in the day room. The undertaker's car was here this afternoon. I am running out of time. When I reached your house, your wife was in the garden, hanging out washing.
I'm looking for Harold Fry.
He isn't here.
Do you know where he is?
I think not.
You must be Maureen. I've bought you flowers.
I'm so sorry.
Why? What have you done?
Just take them, please.
I told the whole story. About you smashing the glass clowns. About Napier. I said I had to leave Kingsbridge.
I suppose you're in love with him and everything.
I'm sorry.
Does Harold even know?
Oh, not at all. I would never know.
Take him if you want. Go on. Or maybe I'll go. There's nothing left for me. It's all broken.
Maureen returned to her washing. She threw my flowers in the basket. And pulled out a t-shirt. Her face softened again and she smoothed the t-shirt as if David was still inside it and she was checking him for creases.
It's only a few weeks, you know, a few weeks since he died, but already I'm beginning to get it wrong when I picture him. I'd give anything just to hear his voice.
But, oh, thanks for the flowers. So if you want my husband, take him. But if you don't, clear off. Get out of our lives.
You were not mine, Harold. And you never would be. It was time to move on. In the night, my door opened and a tiny scrap entered.
I can't find my bed.
It was Finty.
Where the hell have they put it? Oh, here it is. I'm so hot.
She was cold as stone.
Hold me, girl. That's right. I'll be all right now. Just hold me. We had the best time, didn't we? Waiting for Harold Fry. It's been the best time of my life.
This morning, the undertaker. Well, you know what I'm going to tell you. When I left Kingsbridge, Harold, I went in a hurry. I took the early morning bus to Exeter, and from there I would have taken a train to Mars if it had been listed. As it was, I had to settle for Newcastle. The land that you walk, Harold, day by day, I passed in hours. I barely saw it. I took a bus and then another bus. Then I met the sea again. And once again, I had to stop. I was napping in the day room this morning when something woke me.
What's going on out there?
Do you think it's Harold Fry?
Excuse me.
My heart froze. I have not finished my letter. When Sister Catherine returned, she was holding a gift basket.
Harold Fry is not with them, Queenie. He's making his own way, but he's not so well. The others wanted to see you. I hope you don't mind. But they're awfully noisy and rather full of themselves. I told them you were napping. They sent more muffins.
20 years ago, Harold, I thought my life had stopped. I made my home in a timber beach house and I tended my heart in a garden by the sea. But the past was always inside me, Harold. I could not let it go.
And now, Queenie, we must finish your confession.
I saw David the night he died.
I went to the doctor.
Well done.
He gave me these pills. I need to take them now.
I'll get you some water.
Nah, gin will do it.
Does your father know you're taking all those?
Do you ever stop thinking of him? Sad old cow. He'll never love you.
I don't know what you mean.
Do you think I'm so stupid? I couldn't see your love poems were for him.
You should go.
I don't feel so good.
It's because you're drunk. You need to go home. You probably shouldn't drink at all. Not with all those pills.
Shut up!
David!
Want to stay the night?
What?
Can I?
It's 20 years since he asked that question. And you have no idea how many times I have relived it in my head and played my answer differently. But I looked at your son swaying in my sitting room. And I looked at my open bag. He had been through my purse again. And I'd had enough.
Can I stay?
No, go away. You lie, you lie all the time and you take. What exactly are you for? I went to the kitchen. Only this time I didn't pour a glass of water. It was brandy. When I returned, he had gone. He walked from my flat
and hung himself in your cotton shed.
You know it was not your fault. All those years you blamed yourself. But David's death was not your fault. You couldn't have stopped him. Now you have told the truth, you see, you can let it go.
Sunlight laps the white walls. It is a new day. Look, Queenie, we have a visitor. It's Harold Fry. Queenie has waited for you, Mr. Fry, just as you said she should.
Yes, I have walked an awfully long way.
I'll leave you to it.
Hello, Queenie.
Hello, Harold.
It's Harold. Harold Fry.
How do I love thee? Let me count the ways.
I'll step a bit closer, shall I?
Oh. I see it all. The look of horror when you see my face. The pity, the guilt. You walked all this way and you thought I'd be pretty.
I've some small souvenirs in my rucksack. There's a hanging quart. It'd look nice at your window. I just have to, you know, find the thing. Ah, here it is.
I'll hang it up at the window, shall I?
All these years, I waited to tell you the truth in order to be happy. But I see now. It was there all along, my happiness. When you danced in the snow, when I sat in your car, it was in the garden that I made by the sea where the wind played in the chimes. It was even here, in the hospice. I loved you, Harold, and that was enough for me.
Well, here we are again, hey, Queenie?
You in the driving seat, me at your side.
Seems a long time since we met in the stationery cupboard. Funny how life goes.
I close my eyes. I hope I smile. When I wake, you are gone. I am so tired. Sister Mary Anconu sits by my bed. She has no typewriter. She has not used the door.
Your letter is finished now, Queenie.
Something twists at the window and showers the room with stars. So much beauty, Harold, in one small thing. I remember my father.
Where are you? Where is that girl?
Here I am. Here I am.
Ready?
She takes my hand, and it is like touching light.
Put down your pencil. Your notebook. Sleep now.
In The Love Song of Queenie Hennessy, Sophie Thompson was Queenie and Paul Venables, Harold. Sister Mary, Roslyn Hill. David, Monty D'Inverno. Sister Catherine, Elaine Claxton. Sister Lucy, Hannah Genasius. Finty, Jane Slavin. Mr. Henderson, Michael Burtonshaw. And Napier, Sean Mason. It was directed and produced by Tracy Neal.